Versatility of the 88s was demonstrated by their ability to undertake semi-strategic tasks, such as the bombing of Moscow, as well as purely tactical missions against enemy tanks, trains, and troop convoys. By the middle of the war, there was no doubt that the endurance of the Junkers 88A was being threatened by the improved performance of Allied fighters. In response, the German Junkers design team developed the 88S high-speed model. It was powered by two 1,730 horsepower BMW radial engines, giving it a top speed of about 380 miles per hour. The crew was reduced to three, the ventral gondola removed, and a new smoothly glazed nose fitted. Defensive armament was reduced to a single rear-mounted machine gun. These updated models flew alongside earlier A models until the end of the war. From the middle of 1943, the Junkers 88 bomber groups were withdrawn from the Russian front to counter the Allied invasion of Sicily and Italy. In the following summer, they were moved again, this time to France to bomb the Allied beachhead in Normandy. They also operated in hit-and-run intruder missions over England. But by this stage of the war, the German bomber force had effectively ceased to exist, and most of the Junkers 88s left were night fighter versions with airborne interception radar. The Junkers 88 was Germany's workhorse of the Luftwaffe. Almost 15,000 of them were produced and still in production at the war's end. From the maiden flight of the prototype in 1936 through the various models deployed during World War II, the aircraft proved its worth in the air as an incredible bombing and attack plane. The German long-range bomber, the Focke-Wulf 200 Condor, is best remembered, to quote Churchill, as the scourge of the Atlantic. It was originally designed as a long-range passenger airliner, but it was not long before the aircraft's potential as a maritime reconnaissance bomber was recognized. The first of three prototypes flew in July 1937, and these aircraft soon set a number of impressive range records. The Condor's main operational flaw was a weak structure behind the wing, and several aircraft broke their backs in heavy landings. The first military Condor was powered by four 850 horsepower BMW radial engines, which were upgraded to 1,000 horsepower. The new engines gave the aircraft a cruising speed of over 200 miles per hour and a range of 3,200 miles. The crew frequently had to endure patrols of up to 14 hours duration over the bleak Atlantic. One story has it that the captain of an Allied ship, tired of watching a Condor circle over his position, asked the pilot to fly around the other way because he was making him dizzy. The Condor was fitted with two 20-millimeter cannon and four machine guns, while the maximum load of bombs or mines was over 4,600 pounds. Later versions of the aircraft were also equipped to launch a pair of Henschel 293 radio-controlled anti-shipping missiles. The Heinkel 177 Greif, or Griffin, was the only German heavy bomber to see widespread service during the Second World War. It was also the Luftwaffe's sole attempt to create a truly strategic bomber. The Greif was developed because Germany needed a bomber capable of carrying a 4,400-pound bomb load over a range of 1,000 miles at a speed of over 300 miles per hour. Finding suitable engines proved the biggest problem, delaying the aircraft's entry into service until the middle of 1942. The solution the Heinkel designers came up with was to pair up two Daimler-Benz inline engines together in each nacelle. So while the 177 looked as though it was twin-engined with only two propellers, it was actually four-engined. The engines each produced 2,700 horsepower, which gave the aircraft a top speed of over 300 miles per hour at just under 20,000 feet. Normal cruising speed was around 260 miles per hour. One of the ideas in using double engines was to reduce drag, but in practice they proved mechanically troublesome and prone to catching on fire. Nevertheless, the Heinkel designers far exceeded the requirements and produced a plane with a range of over 3,000 miles and the ability to carry a bomb load of over 13,000 pounds. To defend itself against enemy fighters, the 177 was equipped with a 20-millimeter cannon, plus two heavy and three light machine guns. The Heinkel 177 was a classic mid-wing design, which was produced in four main versions, including anti-shipping models. The aircraft also served as a transport on the Eastern Front. The Greif served with nine bomber groups and played a significant part in the mini blitz against England during the first half of 1944, attacking London and southern ports with the Allies assembled the D-Day Armada. The last 177 saw the final act of the war played out in the East. The world's first jet-powered bomber, the Arado 234, was appropriately named the Blitz, or Lightning. It was the result of a need for a high-speed reconnaissance aircraft with jet propulsion. The first prototype did not fly until June 1943, and the aircraft only began entering service in July 1944. The prototypes took off on three-wheeled trolleys, which were jettisoned. The Arado then landed on a retractable skid. The reason was that early jet engines guzzled gas, and nearly all the interior space was needed for fuel tanks, leaving no room for landing gear. In the air, the Blitz was a graceful sight. Despite its use of straight wings instead of ones which were swept, the Arado Blitz was a remarkable achievement and typical of the inventiveness of German engineers in later stages of the war. The bomber version, the 234B, had a top speed of 460 miles per hour at 30,000 feet, much faster than any piston-engine fighter. It was a single-seater, and not only did it have a pressurized cabin, it even had an ejection seat for the pilot. Due to the lack of space in the narrow fuselage, the weapons load of 3,300 pounds of bombs or rockets was carried on underwing pylons. Braking parachutes were introduced early in the program because of the very long landing run using the skid. Even this did not solve all the problems. The aircraft still had to be reloaded onto a trolley before it could be moved. The attempts at landing with the trolley still in place were not successful, and in the end, the fuselage was widened and a tricycle landing gear adopted for these models. The resulting loss of fuel space restricted range to just over 1,000 miles, even with a rocket-assisted takeoff. To extend this, experiments were carried out with the aircraft towing a winged fuel tank behind it like a glider. An interesting feature of the Arado 234 was the twin remote-controlled 20-millimeter cannons fixed in the rear fuselage to fire backwards at any pursuing fighter who got too close. A total of 210 Arado 234s were produced. Most were powered by Junkers Jumo turbojets, delivering almost 2,000 pounds of thrust. Operations using the Blitz were severely limited by Germany's fuel shortage toward the end of the war. The Arado 234 was involved in the Ardennes offensive and also saw action in the Battle of the Bulge. But its most vital mission was in opposition to the Allied crossing of the Rhine at Remagen. The Junkers 87 is commonly known as the Stuka, an abbreviation of Sturzkampfflugzeug, the German name for dive bomber. The Stuka was probably the most decisive weapon used by the Germans at the beginning of the Second World War. An enduring image of Germany's Blitzkrieg victories between 1939 and 1941 is the shape of the crank-winged Stuka powering downhill in a near vertical dive, accompanied by the nerve-shattering scream of the sirens attached to its landing gear legs.